you about this morning is, again, quite different. What you've been doing in the last 4 days is exploring how would you go about preparing a data set for publication, and how would you go about publishing the data set. And right now what I'd like to do is come back to the real world a bit, which is to say, what are your realities going to be if you go back to your home, back to your institution, talk to your supervisor, and your supervisor says, okay, what are the realities going to be? Okay? Or maybe 10 years from now, you are challenged to set up a biodiversity inventory for your state or for your country. What are the challenges that would be? So that's essentially what I want to talk about in this talk. And just get you thinking and maybe get all of us talking about what are those challenges and how can you meet them. Now, let's talk about the realities of sharing data and in the developing world. And what I think you'll see is that the developing world and the developed world are not at all different. So we've talked about a bunch of initiatives. Particularly, we've talked about BERCNET and GBIF quite a bit. And we keep seeing, what, it was 393 million records. That's a lot of information. Are we done? I mean, is that enough? I want to get you thinking about some of the realities. Now, just a very quick illustration that there's still a lot of work to do with data cleaning, which I think you guys already know. But these are just two short illustrations of the types of problems that you're going to see over and over and over in every data set. These are two bird species. And that's giving you the five spellings. This is in BERCNET, by the way. The five spellings that you see of its name. And then this is another bird species, the sandpiper, and all of the different spellings of its name. So there's a lot of dirt in these data sets. And maybe you do your search, and you search on maybe that and that, which are the two names that have been accepted, which aren't misspellings, and maybe you get 95% of the data. But the other way of seeing that is that you lose 5% of the data. So this is just an illustration of how messy things get. And then, remember one of my big foci is on the birds of Mexico. So here are all the different ways that Mexico appears in the BERCNET data set. And that's how Mexico appears in the World Cup, usually. So, you already know that, which is to say you spent this week exploring error in biodiversity data. Okay? Now let's talk about feasibility. Again, imagine that you are in charge of your country's biodiversity information network, or some biodiversity status evaluation, something. Some places are harder than others. So what I want to do is explore with you a couple of examples. This is birds of the world. Now, I keep coming back to birds, and that's partly because that's my training, but it's also the major taxon that has the most complete biodiversity information, which is to say, it's pretty much true that anywhere on the surface of the Earth, 99% of the avifauna will have been described scientifically, right? If you find a new species, that still happens, but it's never more than 1% of the avifauna. So birds are essentially done as far as our basic inventory. Birds have a 300-year history of specimen accumulation, and birds have a huge huge set of people out there doing observational studies. So this is kind of the best case. And any other taxonomic group that you work on, in some sense, will be even worse. Okay? So, this is a project that I've been working on with the help of Laura, and most recently with some help from Javier. But it's essentially an analysis of the digital accessible knowledge of the birds of the world. And so we accumulated 3.4 million specimen records of birds. You can see them displayed on a map. And on top of that, we can put another 80 million observational records. And you can see a lot of things happening here. For example, look at about half of the surface area of Africa, not a single record. Okay? That's pretty hard to fix. Look at most of Russia. Pretty hard to fix also. Now that doesn't mean that there's no information. Remember I said digital accessible knowledge. So these are data points that have been made digital and that somebody's shared. Okay? But even assembling across huge efforts like work that MG did, you can see large areas of the world's surface that are without any information. And that's not to mention the oceans. There's more information out there. We'll come back to that. But the main point of this is simply that some places are harder than others. You know, we can go right now to Honduras. And there's a lot of information. But if we go to Mali right now, there's almost nothing that's digital and accessible. So, I took, I'm not going to go into the details of this, but I calculated inventory completeness statistics. And I did that for each country on Earth. You can't even see all of the labels. One that has a red bar going up to 100% has a very complete inventory. And something here is partially known. And something down here, it's not that it's unknown, it's that there's no evidence that the inventory is complete. Okay? And all I want you to see is that the number of countries with a reasonably complete inventory is negligible. Okay? So right there you get an indication that most countries on Earth don't have a good grasp of biodiversity information, even in the best case. Here's a fun illustration for the United States. The United States has very good observational data sets, the Breeding Bird Survey and the Christmas Bird Count. They're digital, but they're not easily accessible. You have to go to US government websites. They're not tied into the, we can call it the World Museum. So, for example, you can see Lawrence, Kansas right there. You can see Chicago. You can see New York and Massachusetts. Okay? Lots of reports coming from there. But you see Canada is actually doing a better job. There you go, Pat. We can go to Europe. This is a few years ago. But again, talking about completeness of inventory, we see that some countries, or some regions of some countries, are doing quite well, and other countries are not doing very well as far as presenting a complete, robust, documented picture of the completeness of the biodiversity knowledge. Here's South Africa. Now, this is where we go back to the symptoms of biodiversity information that Javier talked about. You can look at this and you should be able to tell me something right away. Where did those data come from in large part? don't we? Have we ever talked about this? When you have imprecise occurrence data, imprecise georeferencing, you tend to get these regular spacings of occurrence points. Okay, in this case, what happened, I'm guessing, is that there was an atlas effort. And the atlas effort had grid squares of, I don't know what size. But what you're seeing here is an effort to portray those atlas data in a very different way as primary occurrence data. But you can see that those are actually less precise geographic references. Okay? Here's Northwestern South America. And again, I'm just trying to show you in general points. Here's the country of Costa Rica, which has lots and lots of sampling going on, either observationally or in terms of specimens. Here's Panama. And it's really interesting, you can see this little strip of very good knowledge. That's the Panama Canal Zone, okay? Then here's Colombia and Ecuador, and we see, and these are the Andes Mountains, very high, very difficult mountains to access. And you can see that the only knowledge of them is in these little strips. That's basically a road that goes up and over the Andes. On the Amazonian side, you can see almost no knowledge. That's the northwestern corner of the Amazon. This is one for Kate. That's the sub, oh, sorry.